What's up, guys? So today is the first night after the clowns have been hatched. So what we do in this process is we make sure that the water is perfect for the fry to live. If we can kind of look over, you can see a few of them swimming. These are the guys that have made it overnight. What I have noticed with the trap is if you do leave it too long, you notice that some of them struggle to swim. And I feel like when they struggle to swim, when you transfer them from here to there, like they tend to kind of be in shock. That's why if they're on a tile, I recommend the tile is the best method of getting more to survive, because with the catching method, it does work. You can see them swimming freely, but again, I feel like you lose a lot of potential fry just because it's such a shock from spinning, moving to here, dumping them, and all that stuff. That's why if you can get them on a tile, I recommend a removable object that's easy to just transfer within a couple of seconds on hatch night. But for the time being, sometimes they do the tile, sometimes they don't. The video I showed you before was them laying on the back of the wall, so I was kind of limited to what they could do. However, this is what we have and pretty much what we're gonna do. So here I have some of the Rotigreen Omega, which I pre-mixed with a little bit of water just to kind of dilute it. Here is our fry tank that are about 3 weeks old, some of them. As you can see, they've got their stripes. They've got a nice orange color to them. Here's the other tank, grow outing. And so here, what I say it's important is the color of the tank. If you can see them, you can see that the fry are swimming freely. So what I will say is important is the color of the tank and the lighting position. So as you can see here, I have a light. It's not directly on the tank, because when it's directly on the tank, it's gonna be too bright for them, especially on day one. They're really, really sensitive to light. So as you can see, it's dark enough where you can't really see the back. Like, here's a heater. You can't really see the back of the heater because it's enough darkness in here to prevent them from swimming along the walls. Your first couple signs that you should see, obviously I put this black, one side's blue, one side's black. I tape it to the front so I can monitor things. And the rest are all painted black, as you can see. Painted black. So you should be able to see the fry like swimming freely as these are. So. As you can see, they're not pressed along the wall. They're not swimming along the bottom. It's not direct light, so it's not really bothering them, but it's an open top where the ambient light from just regular daylight shows, and plus again a little bit of this. As it gets day by day, I do go a little bit lower. I won't stop tinting until about day 8, day 9, which is usually when they're off rotifers completely. So just remember that you need to tint the water for every day that you're feeding rots. So I do see some along the back. If you can tell, they're right here. So that means I need to tint a little bit more just because some of them are being bothered more than others. So I've got, like I mentioned before, my Rotigreen Omega, a little bit of salt just to kind of dilute it so it's not as strong. What I do essentially is just grab, grab a good amount, shake it. And with this water, what I'm gonna do is literally just kind of dose it in here. So I like to dose it near the bubblers. And you'll see it'll start to make the water darker. And again, this just makes it dark enough for the fry not to get bothered by the light, as well as keeping them from swimming along the walls. When they swim along the walls, they're so bothered by the light that they're trying to get away from it and they can't, and then they usually stop eating, and then that's how you get a pile of fry like along the walls and along the bubbler, because they're basically trying to find a way out. So like I said, I'm just gonna keep little drops every couple seconds everywhere. Get it a little bit darker. You don't want to go so dark that you can't see anything. You should be able to see a little bit, but like if you're looking from this view back, you should be able to see at least an inch or two into the tank. But I wouldn't say completely dark where you lose all the fry. So as you can see right there, it's already getting a little bit darker. Gonna add some more drops. What I found is better is having two airlines on opposite sides of the tank. When you have two opposite ones, it seems to kind of control the air better. Obviously you have a lot of fry, you have a lot of oxygen being used between the fry plus the rots. Again, rots is short for rotifers. That's what I just call them. And you're gonna be using a lot of oxygen. So if you have it in one corner only, I feel like you lose all this section that could use more oxygen and more movement, because with no movement, the rots just settle. And then pretty much they start polluting the tank. So we did get a tad bit darker. I don't see the other fry along the wall anymore, which is a good sign. And as you can see, I only got from the parent tank about a little bit over 2 gallons. So what I do essentially to control the ammonia is I add a little bit of water every day, about half a gallon every day, until I get to the 4 gallon mark. I feel like having, you know, the parent tank water is a lot better than mixing, because when you mix, you can mix if it's a tile, but when they're born and you're catching them and then moving them, it's such a shock for them. And then you adding 2 gallons of, you know, new clean water right away is, I feel like you lose a lot more because of the shock. So that's why I've done this method, which is I have about 2 gallons. I add half a gallon every day of clean salt water dripping. That way it's slowly dripping over time and adding, instead of mixing everything at once and expecting them to live. So what I'm gonna show you now is just pretty much what I do when adding the water. And excuse the ambulance, I live by a hospital. So what I'm gonna do is just, right now I've got it to the green that I like. I do see some of the fry still along that wall, which is no big deal, because we could just add a few more drops, as you can see here. again, this is rarely really really strong, so a little bit goes a long way. There's no need to add like a few milliliters, and by few I mean like 5 or 6. You can probably get away with like 2 milliliters, especially with this low amount of water. So I've gone ahead, I've tinted the water. Now it is day one. They've survived. The ones that have survived the night are pretty much low on egg sac yolk, whatever you call it, whatever they're surviving on in their stomachs, which lasts about 24 hours. So I went ahead, I took a gallon out of the rots. I'm gonna go siphon this, rinse it out with clean salt water, and then put that inside the tank. All right, so I've got my clean salt water, my filter, my gallon of rots. Gonna go ahead and just siphon the rots like normal. I've got my rot siphoned. As you can see, they're starting to collect right there towards the bottom. Got a lot of going. You can see like all the cloudiness, I guess if you could explain it, would be the rots. So what I like to do here is now give it a fresh rinse with salt water. This is just something I've been doing, and I read a lot that it helps. You gotta remember the rots are pretty much swimming in their own filth, plus the food and all that stuff. So I just do this extra rinse. I have read it does help a lot. So we got a nice rinse there. We got them all clumped up here in this kind of corner. What we're gonna do is just, once we've rinsed them out, they're all ready to go. We're gonna pretty much just put them into the tank. So as you can see, here's the rots. What I'm doing essentially is just dipping it low enough and slow, kind of like, and then slowly tilting it in. You can see that I got most of it out. So now, plenty of rots everywhere for everybody. And make sure I've got my pumps going. As you can see, it got darker because we added more Rotigreen. I just like to clean the front. Check the bubbles. Make sure they're going at a rate that I like. I'm gonna maybe adjust this one a little bit more. Alright. So now I close it. And the last step, what I'm gonna do is now get about half a gallon of pure clean salt water and drip it slowly into here to bring my two, almost a little bit over two, to about 2.5. I went ahead and I already siphoned out any dead ones that didn't make it through the first night. And pretty much we're gonna go to the next step. So our next step here is preparing the water. I've got my gallon of salt water I'm only going to put half a gallon, just remember, but I make it a little bit extra just to show you, because I didn't want to do half a gallon, but this is what I do. So the first product I use is called ChorAm-X, I don't know. Basically, this is the best powder I've found that helps with ammonia and chlorine in the water. My water is RO water, so I do have a 5-stage outside that detoxifies everything in the tap water. So I just do this more for the ammonia that's gonna start to build up with the fry, obviously. For the first day, it's not really that much that you need to worry about, because you're just putting everything in. So that's why I only really add a little pinch. And I've got a hair. So I add just a little pinch, just because it's not going to make a difference today. Usually when I start adding this a lot, will probably be day 3-ish. Just because now around day 3... your stronger ones have survived. Your rots are starting to settle at the bottom. You need to do a tink cleaning and all that stuff. And then we're just going to add a little bit of green in this. Get it a nice color. You don't have to do it too much, only because remember, your tank is already green. And you're just kind of adding a little bit more. Now we've got a nice kind of greenish color. Maybe we can add a little bit more to this. Because do remember, obviously, your water is going to be clear, and you just got the perfect color on the other tank. So we just do this to make sure. Alright, so our last step for today is just going to be dripping the water into the tank. I'm going to use my trusty rigid tubing that I made to fit inside this, just like that. And we're going to go ahead and drip it in. Alright, so we went ahead. I put the bucket up here just because I have a plexiglass over here. I put my airline tubing with my little adjuster. I've adjusted it to a setting that I like, which is, as you can see here, dripping very slowly. Maybe even take it down a notch. And we're gonna just leave this here for about an hour. It takes for about a half gallon. And we're just gonna let it slowly drip into here. It's gonna bring the water up. It's gonna bring any little ammonia down, just because we've added clean salt water. And it shouldn't affect the color too much, but we will see once it's done dripping. Today is day 2. Day 2, we're pretty much doing the same thing. Here's the tank. You can see the fry swimming around. It's like there. Essentially, we're gonna do the same thing today. Here's my half gallon. We got it on a slow drip today. As you can see, the tank is almost at 3 gallons. Nice green color. What I like to do is throughout the day just check on the color. If you notice that it needs a little bit more color, then go ahead and add some. You don't want it to get clear and then you wake up and it's already clear, and you know the clowns have been swimming along the glass for a while, because obviously that means it's been clear for a while. So just throughout the day, sporadically, check on the greenness of the water. If it's not green enough, add a little bit more. I usually do it maybe 3 or 4 times a day, just a few drops every time, just to keep it green. But day 2 is nothing special. Like I said, just same as yesterday, where you saw me mix this, pour it in, it's dripping. I'm gonna just add the rotifers, the same as yesterday. Gonna get a scoop, about a gallon. I pour it into the container. I rinse it out with clean salt water. Come back, just kind of put it in slowly and tilt it in and let the rotifers come in. And that's it. There's nothing much until day 3, which is your first, should be your first water change. If it's not bad, like if you're not losing a lot, then you can probably just do this again day 3. Just put another half gallon until you get to that 4-gallon mark and then do your first water change. But I do recommend day 3 adding more the ChorAm-X, because that does help with ammonia. Again, day 1 we only added a little bit. The day 2 added a little bit more of what I added in the first part of the video. And so it just keeps increasing a little bit until you get until about a fourth of a teaspoon for every 10 gallons. And that's what I've been doing. So if you want to mix it or if you want to do the math, but I just kind of like eye it for a gallon, or sometimes I mix it with the 5-gallon bucket and I just do that. And that's pretty much it today. So nothing special, nothing really that I haven't showed you on day 1 that I'm doing. And pretty much that's it. So today is day 3. We're gonna essentially do the same thing that we've been doing day 1 and day 2. This is gonna be your day where it decides for you what step to do. I say this because basically at day 3 you should have pretty much your guys that will survive to at least meta alive. Day 1 usually, again, there's enough food in their stomach to last about 24 hours. So day 2 is where you kind of get that first wave of dead fish happening, and then after day 2 they should be only on rots. They should only be on green water and just a combination of rots. Check your ammonia daily, because your first wave of dead fish, obviously your ammonia is going to either spike or go down, or will never go down. It's always just gonna go up, but you just gotta keep it at 0, or at least try to. So day 3 for me is usually either I'm gonna do a water change, or I'm going to just wait until tomorrow and just continue what I did day 1, day 2. In my case, I didn't have a big clutch this time because of stuff that happened basically, so I don't have that many in there, but it's pretty much up to you to decide. My ammonia stays pretty low, that's why I don't really have to. That's what the powder helps for daily. As you can see here, they're swimming around in there. The water's kind of clear, so I'm gonna make it a little bit more green today. It is only day 3, so obviously they're still kind of blind. So I don't put this too high, like I said. It's more horizontal. Day 1, obviously, it's all the way up here, just to ensure that I'm not blinding them. But as the days go by, it's almost like goes down, 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 until about day 8, day 9. Day 3 also, the reason why I say for me day 4 is usually the first water change is because day 3 is when I tend to start adding TDO just a little bit when I'm adding rots. This helps when adding TDO A, which is the little minute size one. It helps when I'm adding this with the rots, because then they know when I'm adding food, like, this is part of the food. And it slowly gets them off the rots into TDOA completely until about this stage, where, as you can see, some of them, these are about almost 20 days, I want to say. So as you can see here, they're still on TDO until they get to the grow out tank, which is this size. I usually wait about a month and a half on these guys to transfer them down here, and then from here separate the ones I like, sell the ones I like, whatever. So day three, again, may be different for you. Usually for me, it's just adding more water, getting me up to that final 4 gallon mark, and then tomorrow I can do a good 1 gallon water change and slowly drip in brand new seawater, which I've been doing anyways, because remember, we started at about the 2 gallon mark, and then day one, we're about 2.5, day two, about 3, and day three, about, I'm gonna be a little bit over 3.5, and then tomorrow, or actually today, I can add the final gallon to make it up to like 4 gallon mark, and then tomorrow I can do a clean 1 gallon water change. So from here, like I said, it's pretty much for you to decide. Test your water parameters first. I test my nitrates, my ammonia, are my two key elements here. So that's the ones I'm testing the most. And that's the one that tells me whether today is a water change or just adding water day. So like I said, nothing special on this day. I'm just gonna put the bucket up here, drip it into here, add rots. And the only difference that I'm doing today, again, is adding the TDOA pellets. I'm adding that when I'm doing the rots with here. So I just kind of like sprinkle it in here and get them all in one corner with the rots. Just kind of slowly dip it, move it around, and get them to come out. That way the pellets are floating, and so they're getting used to the idea of pellet food being introduced. Because come day 5, day 6, I'm gonna be putting less rots, maybe only like a, you know, this container worth rather than a gallon. So this container is 24 at this line right here. So obviously to the max it's 32 ounces. So I'm probably only putting 24 to 32 ounces around day 5, because I want them on the TDO mostly, because that's what's gonna give them the nutrition. Now, if you read forums and stuff, you'll notice that people feed live brine around day 5. But what happens around day 5, if you're not using TDO, is what's called a sudden fright syndrome. So SFS, which basically means that you're introducing live baby brine and the fish just don't know what it is and they scare themselves literally to death. And when they do that, then they're dying as you're feeding them. So I always thought it was a waste. Because first you gotta prepare the day before, hatch them. They can only be baby brine, because if they reach adult form, there's no nutrition value, and they're too big for the fry. Also too, you gotta avoid using egg capsules, because if you put the egg capsules in with the brine and you feed it to the fry, basically it destroys their system as well, or clogs their stomach. Something happens basically to where they die. So you have all these possible scenarios that can happen with live brine. So instead of live brine, I just always been using this AP breed. So with the AP breed, again, it's got all these
crude proteins, fats, and fibers, and it's small enough for the fry to start eating, that it prevents that sudden fright syndrome from happening and from you losing all those fry because they're literally scaring themselves to death because they're in being introduced to a new food. So this prevents that. Definitely worth the money. I mean, this is a 3 ounce, and I've had this maybe at least, like obviously it comes packed like up to here, but I'm like maybe down to here, and obviously it goes all the way down to here. So I've still got like this much amount of food, and so that amount from my finger, index finger, to here, I've only used within like 6 months. So, and then they come in different sizes. So you've got the TDO A, then the next size is B1, and then B2, and then C1, and then it's classified as C2, but it's also classified as small, but it's pretty much the next size. So this helps because you can get them when they're in this size from size A to the next size B1. So you can start mixing in the two foods. Usually I say around day 10, 11, I like to mix the foods, like the size they're currently on and then the next size I want them to get to. That way they, again, you're introducing the food, they're becoming aware of what's being introduced and they're eating it. So it just helps them get to the next size. And then obviously bigger pellets means they eat a little bit more of it and they become bigger faster. And then from here, we can move them down here where they're gonna be to a nice sellable size. So here, you know, we've got a few clowns here, just one of the tanks. We've got some true perks in the back, Bali Picassos. Bali Picassos. And, you know, this is the stage you want to get to eventually. Some of these guys are, I believe, August. And we're in January right now. So a little bit over 5 months, which would be like this guy right here. So there's a mix of them in here from different age brackets. I would say, you don't want to mix them too old with too young, because obviously the older guys will become bullies and pick on the younger folk. If you do have separators, you can't do by clutch, meaning like, you know, these are your 6 months, these are your 5 months, these are your 4 months, whatever you decide to do. But as I mentioned, day 3 for me, I'm gonna just do a quick adding more water. I'm gonna add a gallon. Nothing you haven't seen with day 1. And tomorrow, which will be day 4, which will be our first initial water change, which technically I've been doing small water changes because I siphon out any dead fry anyways. But it'll be our big first major change where we're taking out a good amount of water, not just like 10, 15 ounces of water by scraping the floor. So the next step, the next day, obviously you want to be super careful. You want to make sure, again, I invested in rigid tubing. With rigid tubing, it's stiff, like it's not really bendable. So it allows my airline tube to be attached here and I can get to the bottom of the tank and slowly like hover over things rather than the flimsy airline hose being bending every time you try to do something. Basically, I try to avoid my hand being in contact with the water. You never know what's on your hands. You never know like what oils, chemicals, whatever's on your hand can bother the fish, especially since they're so delicate. So at least with this, my hand's never going in the water. I'm simply siphoning out the fish into a bucket and then adding water, and same thing, you know. So again, sorry for the rant on day three. Even though it's just a regular day, like I wasn't adding anything extra steps. But just in case, to recap, it'll be the gallon container, some of the ChorAm-X to help with ammonia, the syringe, which I'm gonna fill with Omega green water, and pretty much that's it. As you can see here, my clown's laid another clutch. Luckily this time it's on a tile. So if you guys are interested in doing the tile method, please let me know in the comments below, and I can make like a part B, I guess, of just hatch night but with the tile. But all it is essentially is hatch night. I know, I calculate when they laid their eggs, and I know when they're gonna hatch. So then I go ahead and I grab the tile, I fully submerge a container, I put the tile inside the tank with parent water, and I'm just running bubble airline tubing under the eggs. That way it keeps them moving. But that's pretty much it. I do like the tile method more, just because I feel like you get more out of it. Because, you know, with the fry catch method, you do either lose some because they don't go into the trap, or they get exhausted from spinning around so much and then they just kind of die. So at least with that, they're naturally hatching inside the tank, so you get a lot more out of this method. Again, as you can see, they like the back, which is where I made the original video, but this time they decided to do on the tile, which is a lot better for me. So if you want to see that, let me know in the comments below, and I'll do a video for that. All right, until tomorrow.